Hello, everyone. Today, our congregation is holding worship in the park, and so we are pre-recording this worship service for those of you participating online and listening on the radio. We begin with our call to worship. We gather in the name of the living Christ to worship God. Surely God is in this place and calls us to worship in spirit and in truth. God's love is for you and for all people everywhere. May we be renewed in the refreshing spirit of the living Christ. Amen. Let's join in singing our gathering song. Let us pray. God of our fathers and mothers, of all the generations who've come before us, holy is your name. We gather in your presence with praise and thanksgiving for the faithful love you have shown toward your people, for the many blessings you have given to us. Your promises are eternal, and they are backed by the honor of your name. Thank you for your faithful presence among us, even when we are not fully aware of it. Continue to reveal yourself to us. Open our eyes to see you here among us. Open our ears to hear your word. For surely you are with us in this place. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Our first reading for today comes from the book of Genesis, the 28th chapter. Meanwhile, Jacob left Beersheba and traveled toward Haran. At sundown, he arrived at a good place to set up camp and stopped there for the night. Jacob found a stone to rest his head against and lay down to sleep. As he slept, he dreamt of a stairway that reached from the earth up to heaven, and he saw the angels of God going up and down the stairway. At the top of the stairway stood the Lord, and he said, "I am the Lord, the God of your grandfather Abraham and the God of your father Isaac. The ground you are lying on belongs to you. I am giving it to you and your descendants. Your descendants will be as numerous as the dust of the earth. They will spread out in all directions, to the west and the east, to the north and the south. And all the families of the earth will be blessed through you and your descendants. What's more, I am with you, and I will protect you wherever you go. One day I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have finished giving you everything I have promised you." Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I wasn't even aware of it." But he was also afraid and said, "What an awesome place this is. It is none other than the house of God, the very gateway to heaven." The next morning, Jacob got up very early. He took the stone he had rested his head against, and he set it upright as a memorial pillar. Then he poured olive oil over it. He named that place Beth-El, which means house of God. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our psalm is from Psalm 139. O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. You know when I sit down or stand up. You know my thoughts even when I'm far away. You see me when I travel and when I rest at home. You know everything I do. You know what I'm going to say even before I say it, Lord. You go before me and follow me. You place your hand of blessing on my head. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too great for me to understand. I can never escape from your spirit. I can never get away from your presence. If I go up to heaven, you are there. If I go down to the grave, you are there. If I ride the wings of the morning, if I dwell by the farthest oceans, even there your hand will guide me and your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night, but even in darkness, I cannot hide from you. To you the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. When you were a kid, did you ever try to run away from home? Maybe one of your kids? I read a story about a 5-year-old who decided to run away from home one day. Now, his neighbor lady saw him go as she was working out in her garden. He trudged down the sidewalk past her house, hauling a little suitcase in his red wagon. He disappeared around the block. And then a few minutes later, he reappeared and went past her again. Again, he circled the block, and the third time she finally said, "What you doing?" And he answered, "I'm running away from home." So she said, why do you keep circling the block? He answered timidly, 'cause I'm not allowed to cross the street. Well, in our reading from Genesis 28 today, Jacob, the son of Isaac, the grandson of Abraham, is running away from home. He had to. The conflict with his twin brother Esau that began while they were still in the womb has escalated to the point that Jacob is fleeing for his life. Now, it's not surprising that his brother Esau is angry with him. First, Jacob managed to gain his brother's birthright all over a bowl of lentil stew, and that meant he was going to earn a double inheritance. And now, Jacob has also managed to gain his father's blessing. Well, more accurately, he stole the blessing from his brother, which meant he would be in charge of the family when his father died. Because of his trickery, Jacob's father doesn't trust him, and his brother Esau wants to kill him. So Jacob sets out on a 500-plus mile journey to his mother's homeland to find a wife and to let things at home cool down a bit. Now, his mother, Rebekah, hopes that he'll only be gone for a short time to allow Esau to cool off and to find a wife for himself. And then her plan is to send for him, her beloved son, and bring him back home. But as it turns out, Jacob will end up being gone for 20 years, and he will never see his mother again. But that's all in the future. In the text this week, Jacob is running away from his past, uncertain of what lies before him. And it's here, at his most vulnerable moment, that God shows up. It was almost sundown. Jacob found a place where he could stop for the night. He rested his head against a stone as he lay down to sleep. And during the night, he had a Led Zeppelin moment, dreaming of a stairway to heaven. Now, that stairway connected earth and heaven, and Jacob saw these angels of God going up and down the stairway. And then at the top of the stairway stood the Lord, who called out to him, saying, I am the Lord, the God of your grandfather Abraham, and the God of your father Isaac. And the ground you're lying on belongs to you. I am giving it to you and your descendants. Oh, and your descendants, they're going to be as numerous as the dust of the earth. And they're going to spread out in all directions, to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And all of the families of earth will be blessed through you and your descendants. And even more than that, the Lord said, I am with you. And I will protect you wherever you go. And one day I will bring you back to this land. I will never leave you until I have finished giving you everything I have promised you. Despite the fact that Jacob is a trickster, a scoundrel, and a cheat, he has a close encounter of the God kind in his dream. And in this dream, God gives Jacob God's name, Yahweh. Now, that name was considered to be so holy, the Hebrew people wouldn't speak it aloud. Instead, they would refer to God as the Lord. So Yahweh, the Lord, reveals himself as the God of Jacob's grandfather Abraham and the God of his father Isaac, though it appears that he is not yet the God of Jacob himself. But Yahweh, the Lord, God, has a history with Jacob's family and is known through these relationships. God makes a promise to Jacob. It's the same promise that was made to his grandfather Abraham and passed on to his father Isaac and is now being passed on to Jacob. It's a promise of land, a promise of multiple descendants, Now, if your house is anything like mine, that's a lot of dust. A lot of people. And these people have the opportunity to be a blessing to the rest of the world. But not only is Jacob given the same promise, the Lord goes even further, promising to be present and to provide protection for him. It's a very gracious promise, especially given the circumstances. Jacob has just cheated his brother, deceived his father, and now he's running for his life. And yet, God promises to be with Jacob, to keep him from harm, and to one day bring him back home again. God doesn't show up because Jacob was a good boy. Oh no, God presents himself to Jacob purely out of grace. Now, I don't know about you, but a dream like this, an encounter of the God kind like this would rock my world. It appears to have done that for Jacob as well. For when he woke up, the first words out of his mouth were not, "Man, I had a crazy dream last night." No, the first thing Jacob says, "Surely the Lord is in this place." Here he is, in the middle of his running away from home, feeling powerless and all alone, that Jacob discovers God. Jacob experiences God. And so it's no wonder he exclaims, "How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, the very gate of heaven." This close encounter of the God kind was a transformative moment in Jacob's life, one he didn't want to forget. So he turned his pillow into a pillar as a memorial to God, the God who graciously revealed himself. And then Jacob poured oil over the top of it as an act of worship, consecrating this like the people did when they were setting something apart for service to God, such as a king or a prophet or a priest. And then Jacob called the place Bethel, which means house of God. As Jacob experienced, God shows up when we least expect it, and often when we least deserve it. I mean, that's how Jesus came into this world. In a time of Roman oppression and fear in a far out-of-the-way place called Bethlehem, located in a small Roman province of little significance, God revealed himself in the flesh as a little baby, whose name was Jesus. And then 30 years later, when Jesus began his public ministry, he declared to his followers, "I tell you the truth, you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." In other words, Jesus was telling them, "I'm the stairway between heaven and earth. I'm the bridge. I am the way, the only way to heaven. And if you want to get there, you come through me." You see, God reveals God's self when and where we least expect it, and often when we least deserve it. In fact, in Romans 5, it says, "While we were still sinners, Christ died for us." You see, Jesus didn't wait until we straightened our lives out. Jesus didn't even wait until we acknowledged him. No, it says that while we are still sinners, while we were still his enemies, Christ came to die on the cross for our sins and rise again. And he invites us to put our trust in him, to believe he is the way, the truth, and the life. He is our stairway, our ladder to heaven. Sometimes either through our own poor choices or because of life's circumstances, we can find ourselves in some pretty scary places. Those are often the times that God loves to show up, when we least expect it, sometimes in far out of the way places, oftentimes in our moments of fear. God shows up. Even when we made a mess of things, even when we don't deserve it, like Jacob, even when we don't desire it, God comes to offer his blessing and the promise of his presence with us forever. That's the experience of everyone who puts their faith in Christ. They have the assurance of God's protecting presence every day. For God, in his grace, still comes to us in times of fear. Jesus still makes his presence known, and often when we least expect it. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Nearer, my God, to thee. Nearer.
Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Oh, gracious Lord, we give you thanks for all of your gifts to us, for daily food, for health, for each breath we take, for freedom to choose, and for the gifts of your word, your power, and your love. Our hearts are truly overwhelmed, O God, when we consider how you have entrusted so much to us. May we be worthy of that trust. May we be a people who are unafraid to live as fully and as richly as you want us to live. Help us, O God, as followers of Jesus, to multiply all that you have given us, to risk spreading your word and perhaps see it misunderstood, to gamble by loving those whom others think worthy only of hate, to take chances by doing good to those who have not done good to us. Help us be faith-filled and desire to increase your glory and your goodness in this world. Make us people who share in both word and deed that which you have given to us. We pray for the church gathered, both here and around the world, that it may encourage all of its members to discover, develop, and use their gifts. We pray for all who are poor in body or in spirit, for those oppressed and heavy laden, for all who are sick or in despair. Minister by your Spirit and by us, your children, to all those for whom we have prayed, and help us walk faithfully in the path of our Lord Jesus Christ. All these things we pray in his holy name. Amen. Let us prepare now for Holy Communion. People of God, people of life, we gather as a Holy Communion for a meal that has been shared countless times, in countless places, and in countless ways. The first time this meal was shared, Jesus was gathered around a table with a ragged collection of people. Outcasts, betrayers, the power hungry, the fragile, the lonely, the lost. The first time this meal was celebrated, Jesus promised that it was for all time, that whenever the bread was broken and the wine was poured, wherever the story was told around a table, he would be there. So today we remember the story as it's been told a thousand times over. We eat the bread and we drink the wine and we affirm that we all belong at this table and that Jesus is here. So if we come to this table angry, let this bread and wine be our peace. If we come to this table broken, let this bread and wine be our grace. If we come to the table betrayed, Let this bread and wine be our wholeness. If we come to the table in despair, let this bread and wine be our life. For this is a holy table, with food to fill the hungry world and wine to quench thirsty hearts. Thanks be to God. When Jesus ate with his friends, he took bread. And after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Each time you do this, remember me." And then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, passed it to his friends, saying, "Drink, this cup poured out for you and for all people is the promise of God. When you drink it, remember me." In this meal, we remember Jesus' death and resurrection, our hope and our life. We break the bread and we share the cup. We become what we receive, the body of Christ. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, the body of Christ is given for you. Let us eat together. The blood of Christ shed for you, let us drink together. The body and the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Send us now to spread your generosity into all the world through the one who is our dearest treasure, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. A couple of announcements. The men's steak fry will be on Tuesday evening. Men, if you haven't signed up yet, please call the church office today. And women, we don't want you to feel left out. The women's salad supper will be coming up on Tuesday, August 8th. Watch for more details to come. Our radio ministry for today is sponsored by Terry and Cindy Wallace. And the bulletins are sponsored in honor of Phyllis Lutrup's birthday by her prayer pal. Happy birthday, Phyllis. And now we conclude with our blessing. As we leave this place, we know God will be with us wherever we go. At work or play, at home or on vacation, we know God will be with us wherever we go. Whether we're happy or sad, on our own or with our friends, we know God will be with us wherever we go. So let's go with joy because God goes with us. Thanks be to God. Have a great week, everyone.